Welcome back to PGL Tavern Tales. We are in for a treat because there's the last match of the entire tournament. With me, Nimsh and Raven, we're here to cast the grand final between Tassin and Stan Sivka. Tassin so far is undefeated in the entire tournament. He was wrecking havoc in the group and he was wrecking havoc in the playoffs as well. While Stan Sivka was coming back from the lower bracket and now he has to defeat Tassin twice. Not in just one game, but he has to win two matches because it's a double elimination bracket and the winner from the winner's bracket has an advantage.
And this is huge because not only if Tassin loses the first one, he just has the strategy, he loses. And if he loses, we'll have bounce and picks again. So mm-hmm. he can change the strategy, change the decks, and maybe have an absolutely different lineup to fight versus Stan.
Exactly. Raven, what do you have to say about Tassin?
Yeah, I think Tassin's been really impressive all tournament. There's just been like one matchup or maybe two that he's had a bit more of a rough time in, but in general he's a very consistent play and he's knocked out certain players multiple times as well. He's played against JJ a couple of times as well, and he's performed really strong, so I'm expecting big things. I think he have a really good chance of taking it, especially because as you guys have said, he is in the winner's position, which is a huge advantage. Like if you're having a second chance in one set of series versus a single opponent, as you said, you know the lists. You can test out a strategy to a certain extent, and then at worst, as a backup, you can alter things and make some adjustments. So I think he's got a really strong chance versus Sivka, because he's already beaten him once as well.
Yep, he has already beaten him once, and now we have the bans. So let's take a look at the bans and talk about that. Nimsh, what can you tell me about the first wave?
So the first wave, both players banned Druidrin, was one of the prominent decks in this tournament. Whenever not banned, it was free-owing. But the fact that the Druid is banned gave them a chance to pick up a Warrior. They have really similar deck lists. I think there is only one difference. There is Onyxia versus Grommash. I believe Stan is playing Onyxia and Grommash is for the Tassin. But this is just the beginning. The interesting thing happens in the second phase.
Raven.
Yeah, and we see the Paladin ban from Stan Sivka. And when these guys last played, Tassin actually went 2-0 with his Paladin and then lost the mirror match as well. So, and the mirror match in really any class is going to be a tough one to play. So even that loss isn't detrimental to Tassin at the time. So that's not going to be available, where we can see Stan Sivka does have his Murloc Paladin. And it's the kind of strange, or at least I think it's a bit of a strange list because he doesn't play Tyrion.
No Tyrion, no Ragnaros, no Barnes, but enter the Coliseum.
Yeah, it's not too surprising as well. Stan Sivka prefers his sort of tech cards and sort of some more funky choices. And it's been, served him well so far. So we'll see how that one goes up. But on the other side, Tassin has been wreaking havoc with his Hunter as well. He actually 3-0'd early in this tournament with it. And Hunter has a really strong matchup versus the Paladin and, pretty decent versus the Mage as well.
And against the Warrior as well.
Yeah, it's not too bad at all.
I mean, it depends on the minions, how they will pair, and the curve, how it will look for both players, because the both of those decks are kind of dependent on that, right? They're being mid-range, but the advantage from Warrior is the fact that he has the executes, while the Hunter has freezing traps. Basically, those are the weapons for the tempo gain in this matchup. But also the third pick. The third pick is the Warlock for Tassin, and for Stan Sivka is the Mage. And if I recall correctly, Stan Sivka is playing Freeze Mage.
Yeah, that's the Freeze Mage from Stan Sivka and Standard Zoo for Tassin. So at least in the third pick, it seems like Stan Sivka has an advantage because Freeze Mage normally has a really good matchup versus Zoo. One of the matchups you want to face. So overall, if we look at the matchups, there is a mirror match in the beginning, then Hunter, Paladin, Hunter good versus Warrior versus Paladin. I think it's kind of even, actually, Paladin versus Hunter.
I don't know. I think the Hunter just wrecks.
You think Hunter is better?
Yeah. I think unless something goes really wrong, if Hunter can just even curve okay, I think it just wrecks the Paladin quite a lot, to be honest. I think the one for Tassin to beat is going to be the Freeze Mage. I think that's the deck he's going to have to take out of Sivka. That will be the main hurdle, I believe.
Okay, but we will be starting off with the Warrior versus Warrior. So, well, a matchup that is favoring the guy who has the weapon. Right, because this is the tempo gain that you have in the beginning. What do you think, Nimsh?
Yeah, I do agree. This is a big thing about tempo. Not only the weapon, but also just having the dragons, having the possibility of those Alexstrasza champions getting into the minions. I've many times realized also how strong Frothing Berserker is. Mm-hmm. If you can't deal with the Berserker early, it's just going to deal a lot of damage, giving an advantage to your opponent. Twilight Guardians. There's a lot of cards that are important, but early game is king. Whoever gets the early game is really favored to take the whole series.
Yeah, there's not a lot of opportunity opportunities for the Warrior to swing a heavy board back in their favor outside of, say, having a few minions of your own combined with good executes. But yeah, I think speaking about the Frothing and a few of the other minions, we can see the Face Monkey as well. The Blood to Ick is going to be really nice to help out with that extra damage, because a lot of the Warrior stuff does three, early on at least, and that Blood to Ichor can really change everything, because you actually gain the 2-2 as well.
Yeah, that's true, but he mulliganed it away. Anyway, the game is starting. I'll leave you guys to the grand final between Tessen and Stansivka.
Thank you so much, Lothar. All right, so Tessen, I was afraid that he's not having any spells, because sometimes spells can be huge tempo gains, as Execute, for example, dealing with the Twilight Guardian, but he got that Execute, so now it's fair on both sides. Actually, face is fine as well. Like, you can go face with everything, maybe?
You just clear the 2-2, though, right?
Yeah. Okay, like clear the 2-2 and go face with the rest, because if you just run two minions into Frothing Berserker, I don't see a good way.
Well, look at the health difference. It's on half the health there, so he can continue to apply pressure. But I believe Sifka is pretty much all in with this plan. He needs to hope for a really good draw next turn that he can either continue to develop the board or maybe get a weapon to help with some removal to keep his minions alive for that repeat damage.
Here I kind of like Twilight Guardian again, I think, and killing the 3-2, because your opponent has no cards in hand, so they will need to get a specific card to just make it awkward for you. But if you kill the 7-3, then Twilight Guardian blocks two minions, like kills 3-2 and 3-3, and then 2-6 has to go into Frothing.
And it dies, so it clears the board effectively.
Exactly.
So this draw from Sifka is going to be very important here, because Tessen does have the opportunity to come back into the game, and that is not a great draw.
It's not.
It allows him to put a chunky minion on the board.
It's a body.
But versus all the fact that Tessen's just got more cards at this point. Corruptor would have been nice if there was a dragon available as well, but that's the whole problem Sifka has at the moment, just having one card at a time.
And Corruptor is going to be perfectly countered by the Curator, just having a 4-6. But you basically can't just ignore this Frothing on board. This Frothing is just going to flip the health totals super fast. And if you don't kill the 3-6, you're in a bad position. And then if you don't kill the Frothing, you're in a bad
position. Yeah, you just have to trade everything here. You're going to take too much damage. And like on the backswing, although Sifka is ahead on health, that won't matter when there's a Frothing Berserker hitting you every turn. So this is the only real option Sifka has. He's kind of just got to hope at the moment that Tessen's got a few dud draws. But when there's going to be four cards in hand, there aren't that many bad draws left.
And that's a Draconic Crusher.
And this Curator is probably going to seal the deal, actually.
So Murloc, Monkey, way more and a Dragon. Resources.
Yep.
There's Dragon, there's a Monkey, there's a Murloc. Three cards, a 4-6. Pretty good deal. So here you can't kill the 4-6. And if you play the Frothing, like, it seems over from this perspective, but the guys, they still have the big cards. If Stan picks Onyxia next turn, you can just slam Onyxia on board. That's a big swing overall. I believe he's playing Ragnaros still. Ragnaros is a very good card. Yep. It can still win you.
The Grom's awesome here. You can just kill off the Frothing and then kill off the Corruptor. Or just go face, really, if you want. Oh, is he going to guard the more health? I suppose it doesn't matter. There's either an Execute or there's not, right?
Yeah, I like it. I think it's fine.
Yep. You have more health on the Taunt. And there we go. Sifka draws his own Curator, which gives him at least a hope of drawing some extra cards. And he can actually, because he's going to draw Finley, this opens up more options for him going forward, because his hero power doesn't really do anything in this matchup.
Yeah,
and he's already ahead on health, so none of these.
Shapeshift is dealing damage at least. Totemic Call can give you a totem that can block stuff, but it doesn't matter that much. I think Sifka is, at this point, Sifka just wants to deal as much damage as possible because he is ahead on damage, I think. But Destin has so many cards, it's just crazy.
Oh, it's kind of frustrating, actually. That's one of the few times you kind of want the Priest heal from Finley, because he could have actually healed Grom, traded it into the 4-6, and then kept Grom alive.
You can't be too disappointed about this as well, because you have a good way to kill the 4-4.
Yeah, it still works, yeah. You would have liked to kept like multiple taunts up, right?
Possibly, but a 3-4 is still good, even if your opponent gets the cards, because you know what cards there are, more or less. Like, 100% was Finley, 100% was Fierce Monkey, there are no other beasts, and a dragon, whatever dragon that was, like, sure, I do have my board. So it's not a Ragnaros. It might have been Onyxia, but even if it's an Onyxia, you should have a good situation here. There is 4, 10, 11, plus 2, 13, 16, 19, 23 damage. 24 damage, 27 damage.
Just keep counting.
Well, there's taunt in the way, so you can't win this turn, but that's a lot of damage overall.
Yeah, and you can even still use Grom to clear up the 3-6, you know, with only using one minion that survives anyway. It's going to go for the Azure Drake for the draw, just to see if there's an execute or anything like that. There's one execute left, right? So he used one,
for Tessin. Stansivka used both executes. Yeah, Tessin still got one.
Okay,
yeah.
So this is looking pretty rough for Stansivka so far. Just even the 9-9 isn't going to quite get the job done.
Just out of resources. And Tessin, if he wants to be super safe, he can even trade the 9-9 with the 10-4. But
he's going to do it.
Yeah, he's going
to
do
it. He's removing the chances he has to lose this game.
Exactly. Exactly.
He's just saying, look, it would be cool to go Grom again to face for another 10, but how about I just remove the 9-9 and then realistically with this board and two Draconic Crushers and a Corcoran, what's actually left in Sivka's deck?
There's no way
going to win the game?
There's no way to draw cards anymore because you've used your Finley, you've used your Curator. I think he used like one Azure Drake already. Mm-hmm. So maybe there's like one more Azure Drake to draw some cards, but it's not enough. And with this situation, Ragnaros would be great, but Ragnaros is not even that good versus a 9-9 Crusher, because then Crusher just tanks the hit and still can attack for 9.
Yeah, exactly. And Tessin's going to be able to actually activate the Crusher, as you said, to make it a 9-9, and it's just going to swing out of control now. Sivka was on the back foot for a long time, just about holding on with the Curator draw, really. But this is going to be the final nail in the coffin, I believe.
Just clear the board, Azure Drake, so the
Is there anything you can even Drake into?
Not having any more executes in the game.
Corcoran.
So this is
doesn't even
damage.
Keep him alive. Yeah, he can't actually hero power, and there's the ping anyway to negate it. So
that's so big because that's a Dragon Warrior mirror, which means that Tessin right now has that Dragon Warrior to a play versus other decks of Stansivka, and there is the Murloc Paladin, and the last deck was Freeze Mage.
Yeah.
So Dragon Warrior is, I think, okay versus Freeze Mage if you play correctly, because you can be really aggressive. You have the armor. If you don't, just Finley turn one into Fire Blast, then you do have that armor up that can be important. So.
Yep.
This is very big, not only because he's getting the lead.
Both players then almost in sync with the drinks.
Yeah.
Both just took a drink, put it down exactly the same time. Both on the same wavelength. But it is going to be Stansivka in game two picking the Murloc Paladin versus Tessin's Dragon Warrior.
Is he just going to get that Fire Blast I just said?
Maybe. But I feel like in this matchup, the Warrior kind of just has to go super aggressive.
Yeah, you want to.
And just try and end the game. We see Finley turn one. You don't care about armor. You're not going to win the late game against anything piled in, so just go as aggressive as possible. And
Shapeshift is really good, though, because not only you are still getting armor, which can matter. Sometimes Freeze Mage just wants to finish you with, let's say, 17 damage, but if you consistently
Freeze
get armor.
Mage? This is Paladin.
Oh, this is Paladin.
This
you're
is
right.
Paladin
I thought it's going to be Freeze Mage.
It's been a relatively long day. It's pretty warm, but
well,
come
he
on,
has
come
a Freeze
on.
Mage. He has a Freeze Mage left.
He does.
And I thought like he's going to take Freeze Mage at some point, but... So I was saying Fire Blast against the Freeze Mage. Against Paladin, it's a different story. You definitely want to be super fast here.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, actually going for the tokens. Just be able to continue to chip away and apply pressure. Corcoran, not really what he was after. I think he went for the hero power there of the Paladin because...
Turn two.
He just wanted to guarantee something better than just one damage to turn two. At least the token can do some work with trades if required.
So let's evaluate the hands. So basically you say... He didn't have the turn two. He got Corcoran. He's not happy, right? What about Paladin? Paladin mostly wants anti-aggro cards and wants to draw. So Doomsayer would be great. There's no Doomsayer here. There is no Vigil. There is Acolyte of Pain that can draw some cards.
Yeah.
But
I think
True Silver Champion.
I think the most important card at the moment in Sivka's hand is actually True Silver Champion, because you know you deal with some of the huge threats, or at least the frustrations of the monkey we can see in hand, but also Frothing Berserkers can cause you some real trouble if you can't deal with them quickly. And True Silver just answers them pretty straightforward, so it's going to be pretty nice for him. And he has access to some draw as well, the Harrison being one of the different cards in the list, I guess, for this Murloc Paladin that's going to potentially get some work done and help with Cycle. So
definitely.
I think Sivka's got a well-rounded hand at the moment. Nothing mind-blowing, but the True Silver, I think, is the MVP here.
And for the turn, I guess, like, dude up and pass. Because
yeah,
you don't want to
a lot of the time, there's no point just randomly throwing the Murloc away. But, wow, Sivka just
randomly throws the Murloc away.
Well, you know, trades with a 1-1, I guess. But I don't know. I like in that situation, I don't mind keeping it. But the idea is that Finley's just going to kill the token.
Yeah.
And then go from, and then the token's going to get some more work done. So it's okay. And it's not like he had a War Leader in hand to try and wait. later on, you know, to do like a 4 damage.
Yeah, exactly. Lugo. There's like some more into it as well, because he maybe thinks that with Acolyte of Pain, he might get more cards in hand. So this Bluegill will just, he'll be close to 10 cards in hand. So maybe Bluegill will be more of a liability instead. But he does not have that many cards. So I'm not sure about that Bluegill. I was probably fine with the 1-1 as well.
Yep, so he's going to go for the True Silver Champion, going to clear out the monkey pretty clean. Well, as clean as it's going to get. And yeah, not looking too bad. And I feel like Tessen's hand has been too slow for what he would want. He's starting to put together some damage now. He does have the Corcoran Elite, of course, for some initial burst damage, but it doesn't feel great.
He also has the Guardian now with the pickup of Fire Dragon. Guardian does stop that weapon from attacking and killing it, so it's only one less attack. A second True Silver will be quite good overall, and with the Keeper just reducing the Dragon, it's a perfect kill.
This is really nice. It just shuts down, as you said, the frustration of the Twilight Guardian having 6 health. Kind of awkward to deal with. It's not like you really want to consecrate that board either. So you consecrate one of the tools, you want to wait and try and get the Equality Conk off later to deal with, you know, a board that may be overrun.
And this looks good for Stan, because Tessen is struggling to put up a fight. If he plays the Corcoran, goes phase 4 or 5, it's not much, but it's something. So he just has to be as aggressive as possible. Next turn, he'll be able to play the Crusher, but I doubt he'll be able to deal enough damage to put Stan to 15. Stan has the second True Silver Champion. Even though it's off mana, it's still a great card. Just dealing the 4-3 with an weapon attack, then killing a 2-2, I believe, with the 3-3.
Yeah, what he has on board now pretty much clears up what Tessen has on his side over the course of a couple of turns at least. So, you know, the second True Silver coming out this early is huge, actually. You get so much value, but there needs to be, you know, Sifka's probably hoping for Forbidden Healing at this point, or just something. He does have the Ragnaros, but that's a few turns away, and for all Sifka knows, there's even more aggressive cards in Tessen's hand.
Well, the thing is, like, he doesn't have an answer to the Crusher. So, next turn, Tessen is going to kill the 3-1 or 3-2, depends on where Sifka attacks, doesn't matter, it just it dies anyway. And then it's just going to drop the 6-6. And then Sifka is nothing. Just will need to either play Harrison as the body, or go for Acolyte of Pain, maybe try to, or just even draw cards with Vigil. Oh, is he just not going for Crusher because
no,
he got
I like this because of Champion.
All right, yeah. So this changes, but he didn't have Champion before, so this changes the turn.
And now he's got the opportunity to push him below 15, which makes the Crusher even a bigger threat.
Yeah,
that's gaining like half again as much attack and health.
So Champion was a really good card there to combine with the Ghoul. But this also, this was possible because Stan attacked into the 2-2 instead of the 1-2. That's what
I mean, I think you just always attack it with the 2-2 anyway. You just remove the most damage of the board, so not a particular big problem there. And Sifka's just committed with these 2 Acolytes, saying, I kind of need to draw something big next turn and give him as many chances as possible.
Well, he will have to draw something, because if those dudes go for face, you put Sifka to 9 and then you play Crusher. So you say, okay, you have to kill the Crusher or heal yourself, because this is 9 damage coming your way, and there's also the free ghoul. Mm. And there's only 7 mana, so normally Ragnaros is 8 mana. He's playing Ragnaros, actually. He's not playing Tyrion, he's not playing Barnes, but he is playing
Ragnaros. Okay. I thought he wasn't playing either. So here, though, for Tessen, I would actually really like just a face attack. Normally it feels great to just kill an Acolyte.
I like face attack as well.
In like one hit. But the thing is, even with Finley, it's very difficult for Paladin to actually get multiple chains from the Acolyte without the use of a Wild Pyro. But if your opponent's like Wild Pyro and then playing spells that aren't equality, which would only get you 1 draw anyway, then, you know, the additional card's going to make that much of an impact when you provide this much damage. And Forbidden Healing is an option now. He can heal for 14 if he wants to go for the full turn. I imagine there might be a Wild Pyro this turn to get the additional draws. The frustration is, though,
first you draw cards.
Yeah.
Definitely draw the card first.
Because if there's an equality, this changes everything.
Yeah, if there's equality, you're in a great spot. Ooh. Alder Peacekeeper is also very good, because before you didn't have a way to deal with the 9-9. If you heal, if you even heal for 14, it's like you're healing, you're healing for 5, because then you get that damage to the face. Mm-hmm. Is he going for Forbidden Healing anyway? Just getting that damage to get
more
cards?
Well, he'll probably
go
for the Aldar into Forbidden Healing, right?
Oh, yeah, that makes sense.
That's fine.
Make sense? Oh yeah,
he has Leon Hands and he has Ragnaros. Okay. So he doesn't need the full heal.
And he obviously has to play the minion before.
And he would like the additional card draw from the Acolyte to get a full 3 cards from this guy. So that's looking pretty good, as Sifka can now is looking all right with a bit of a more full hand and guaranteed at least 1 more card draw as well.
The problem might be that if he plays Ragnaros, there might still be some minions that are damaged on board. But overall, I think Sivka is stabilizing slowly. Next turn is turn 8, so he has have that Ragnaros and lane hands. And Tessin doesn't have that much pressure anymore. He doesn't have any bombs at the moment, so he might be forced to trade. Like, you always want to kill the Pyromancer because shenanigans. You probably want to go face... Oh, he's trading with 3-2 to protect the 3-4. Okay, that makes sense.
Yep, this is fine. So you remove Pyro, so that's you know, one less opportunity for Equality to really get some work done.
Yeah, but Equality is still good here. You can Equality, you can attack into the 3-4, then you Bluegill into the whatever, and just do
yeah,
that.
Yeah, it was good this turn because he drew Bluegill.
Yeah, exactly.
Like,
exactly.
Up until that point, it was looking a little bit rough, to be honest.
Yeah,
you
agree,
probably
I
have
agree.
To go for the Solemn to try and get something else.
Oh, Doomsayer as well.
Yeah, this is almost certainly going to be a Doomsayer turn.
Yeah, but he
because
first
he can
Jogard's
solve Vigil as well, yeah.
Vigil
looking
for one.
Nice.
So good, so good. And then you just play Doomsayer to ensure that there is nothing on board and you can follow up with the Ragnaros.
Ah, second Doomsayer as well. This is looking really good for Stan Sivka now. He was under quite a lot of pressure, but he's managed to stabilize and now he's got all the healing he could need. And this is hitting the point where Tessin's running out of juice, basically. So he won't be able to pile on enough pressure after these big heals come out.
Now just drop that Ragnaros.
Yep.
And drop the mic. Like, yep, that's it. You either have an execute or you just lose the game because I'm going to attack with this 8-8.
Yeah, well, the thing is as well, I really like the rag because there's no minions on board. So, and you've seen the hero powers already depiled in hero power. So there's no fear of like a Finley proc as well. So, you know, your opponent's going to have a proc and an execute in three cards. And then what's his follow-up going to be? It would have to be insane to have all three of those things.
Oh man, that consecration is going to do so much work. Just attack into frauding, you consecrate, and then you play War Leader. Up. Like, you can do whatever you want. You can even just attack and then like heal yourself with the Ivory Knight afterwards to have more board. But this is just... Tessin, this is the first damage he's taking. But I would not be mad if he just concedes
he
here.
He chooses
because that's
death,
it.
Yeah. I mean, that's it. You know, at that point, Sivka's fully stabilized and there's nothing he can really do about it. So Sivka does even up the match at 1-1 with his Murloc piled in. Well, now we're going to see what Tessin's going to lock in. I would be amazed if it wasn't his Hunter.
Hunter versus Paladin. So you said this matchup is pretty good for the Hunter. And
yep.
You say mostly because of the Defrauder cards, right? Like when you try to deal with Doomsayer dealing with the cards, like the most
it's a combination of the frustration of the Death Rattle cards, the fact that you can play on curve from very early on and pile on a lot of pressure, and your finishes of, say, Call the Wild. You know, out of nowhere, board presence and instant damage. And on top of that, you had the hero power. So,
yeah.
You know, I think Hunter is such a good matchup. If I could pick almost any deck to go against Paladin of this variety, I would go Hunter.
I also like Cthulhu Warrior against Paladin, but...
That's scary, though, right? Because any warrior, even like control, you're always afraid of just the Ivory Knight into a third anything.
Oh, yeah, that kills
like,
you 100%.
Because then you just die.
Yeah.
So
like, normally, you can escape the range. You just need to have around like 50 health. And then you're good, whatever happens. Mm-hmm. But yeah, Hunter makes a lot of sense. And then Stan will have to get like a perfect hand. Doomsayers, Pyromancers early,
yeah.
Aldor for a high main. There's a lot of good things you need to have to stop Hunter. And Hunter normally doesn't need that many cards. It's so stable, like such a... such a good deck.
And I think as well, like, if you compare Hunter versus a control warrior in this matchup, you've got to bear in mind that the Hunter's plan is very straightforward, whereas the Control Warrior match can get very intricate as well. So, you know, you just play the easier matchup.
Well, Stan basically will need to clear the board, heal himself, because he's taking some damage, whatever happens, there are chargers. And then also, in the meantime, try to accumulate the combo cards to win the game versus Hunter.
We can see now one of the sort of rough points in the deck building for this Hunter deck.
Ooh.
Versus the Murloc Paladin, is Tessin is running double Explosive Trap, which...
doesn't matter.
You'd rather have two other cards against Murloc Paladin, let's be honest. Tracking is going to be okay early on. I normally never like turn one tracking. Oh, well, I never like to have tracking in my hand turn one because you never, you know, you don't know what answer you're going to need at this point unless it's literally into a two drop in a highly aggressive matchup. But it's not looking too bad. The frustration now is that the kind of grandmother will get propped by the 1-1 if there's an answer.
And you can play the Doomsayer to deal with a 3-2, block the turn from the Hunter. Possibly, and then Stan actually got a pretty good hand here. Not only he got the Doomsayer, oh, he's not even proccing it this turn. So he got the Doomsayer, he got the Consecration, and got the Pyromancer. This is pretty good. He got the heals as well. So I think Stan's hand is fine. Like, maybe Leon Hands is bad in a way. Like, you don't want to have Leon Hands in the opening hand. But overall...
It depends how the game goes, though. I mean, yeah, it's bad in the opening hand, but having it available to you as guaranteed heal later on is going to be pretty okay, especially when the rest of his start looks like this. Yeah. You know, you're okay with having Leon Hands if you've got all the other answers early on to get you to turn 8.
No, but even with the Huffer, so Huffer was good for Stan, not good for Tessin.
Yeah.
He wanted the Misha. Like, this enabled this wonderful consecration there.
Okay, so what's the Animal Companion? There's the Misha. Going to be able to follow up with the Toad as well. So again, and this is the thing that, like, why Hunter's pretty good in this matchup is that you know, the board was cleared with a great Consecrate, but now, same problem. It's like, do it again.
It's back.
And then turn 5, Tessin has access to Bow, Hero Power. I doubt he would go for the Explosive Trap at all. You know, yeah, I think that Explosive Trap's going to be played when you're going to float 2 mana, basically.
Yeah. Just like maybe... pull him low enough, and when he goes for the Murloc combo, he's at 2 health, so he actually kills himself.
Yeah, but also, you know, Sifka's is fully aware that there's the Explosive Traps in the deck, and like I said, you just play Explosive Trap when you have 2 mana floating on the turn, which can often happen late game with Hunter.
So now what's the best way to kill this Doomsayer? Just Eagle Hornbow and quick shot into the 3-3 seems super solid. You keep the board, your board is still pretty good. You will have the Hymen in the next turn. So you're pretty happy about Aldor being played earlier in the game. But this means you are also still not dealing that much damage, and Stan can just play Ivory Knight, so another nice minion.
Yeah, but, you know, Ivory Knight is a nice minion, but you know it's going to die next turn. If Tessin wants to kill it, it is dead. And also, the heal for only 4 Ivory Knight feels kind of rough. There are other options available.
Yeah, but still, if he wants to kill it, like, he will have to use the weapon and the Misha dies, the weapon gets off the charges, and you will only play the Hymen. So I like Ivory Knight here as a card for sure.
Yeah, out of his other options, you need to hold on to like the Pyro Consecrate for a much bigger impact.
Yeah,
end up getting the Hammer of Wrath, which is actually pretty nice. On-demand removal and additional card draw. It's going to be pretty good in this matchup overall.
Getting Humility will be good as well, but there was, what, like Noble Sacrifice, and the second seat, there was like one more one drop, which weren't that good.
Yep. Now we're gonna go for the Toad kill. No, we're not. We're just gonna push face. Why not?
Toad kill is the road kill.
Okay. So.
No equality. Can you do something good here? Can you actually? No, not really. I don't see. So he needs to draw the cards. So I was thinking, like, if there's any way to proc the Savannah High Main and then consecrate the hyenas and everything else.
But I like this ordering, though, because the Toad might hit the Acolyte for an additional card draw. Yeah. It feels pretty good. Nope.
It didn't.
It hits the Ivory Knight instead, which is still, it's fine.
Well, the big thing is that Stan is at 27. He has a lot of cards, and Tessin is slowly running out of cards. Plus, he doesn't have the Call of the Wild yet. Hymen is obviously great, but he's fighting for board here. Just probably going to go 8 to face. So we'll see. Like, this game is still undecided in my head.
Yeah, it's looking okay, though, because you've seen one Aldor Peacekeeper, so this Hymen is a very, very real threat now, and obviously there's the Howlmaster as well, which is anything to be sniffed at for attack also, so, and there's no equality either to even deal with the first issue of the Hymen, never mind the hyenas that come out afterwards. If there was Pyro equality Conk, then that would look pretty good.
And he can't even lay on hands. Like, I think this turn is Ivory Knight. Try to get Humility. If you don't, just heal yourself with whatever, and then Doomsayer. So this is... Well,
oh,
maybe
Redemption?
Not really. Redemption?
Well, I was thinking, is there ever a point in going for Redemption with Doomsayer?
No, I don't think so.
It depends how the board looks,
right? Not on this board.
I was going to say, like, I'm not saying for this turn, obviously, but for
sometimes there is.
Because Hunter kind of struggles to deal with one damage. And if it puts in, like, a 4 attack minion into a 0-1 Doomsayer, then sure.
Yeah.
It's effectively healed a little bit more.
So he just took the card, which was basically healing him for the biggest amount. Plus, he knows that this attack is getting into Doomsayer. So with a 4-4, if he buffs it, he will be able to actually kill the high main, and then he can cast Consecration to clear the hyenas. So that was actually pretty good for him. Not only healing for 4, but also giving him a tool here. Is there a freezing chop in the Tessin's deck? Or is it just...
I think it's just double explosive.
So Stan Sivka is 100% sure this is an explosive chop.
Now he's just playing with the idea of saving Barnes for, say, like, the board refill, right?
Yeah.
The bat isn't too impactful as he's kind of rely on just having a beast for a second kill command. He's already used one. So, you know, that's the main synergy you want to maybe hold on to a beast for as an easy activator. But, you know, having barns in case this board gets fully cleared, you can just barns and hopefully, you know,
oh, yeah.
Hopefully get the second high main. And so that's what you're really looking for.
And Tessin is playing this off, right? I think he is playing this off in this list, which means that if the game goes long enough, he might actually get the everything back with himself anyway. All right, so for Stan, like, if you go Blessing of Kings, Consecration, you leave the 4-1 on board, and you obviously lose your 8-8 as well. But that still might be the best play you have available. And
yeah, you can't take a hit again this turn, because also you don't know what the next card is or next two cards for the hunt. If you even if you say like lay on hands to try and draw into a more powerful turn next turn with an equality, then you could just die. So you just can't take that risk. And I think we're gonna have to see the Consecrate come out here.
It's just reducing six damage off the board, and that you're taking one, so you'd go down to 16 with the attack. You go down to 12, and the hero power is 10. But you should be pretty much safe. The problem is, if there is Call of the Wild, it's so bad for you.
Yeah, and that's the kill command as well. So
no beast, though.
We were saying, like, oh, it's no beast. There could be a beast come out, and the beast has come out because the kill command's turned it yellow. And it's pretty good.
That's not a bad beast.
No, that's pretty good. You just want anything that's frustrating for the paladin to deal with.
Oh, but now with Blugil, you can actually kill the 1-1, and then you can Pyromancer with Forbidden Healing.
Does leave the barns up, which is kind of frustrating.
Yeah, but you do heal for 12, so you go to 22. Now it also depends on how much health you want, because your opponent only has one card, so and you have Lay on Hands. So it's not like you really have to heal for 20 right now. You can try to also build up the board at the same time. You don't have to, like, you maybe just champion, kill the 3-4, and then Bluegill the 1-1, Pyromancer, and just Forbidden Healing for two, which is healing you for 4. But you clear the board, and
there's a chance as well that you could actually just go True Silver into the 3-4, Bluegill into the Howlmaster, and just leave the 1-1 on the board. Because although it's a beast, you've seen one kill command, and if Call comes out, then it's 7 damage that turn. Well, 9 because of the hero power, because it'll be turn 10. And you could save the Pyro.
It's playing around this off a bit, because then, like, 1-1 is...
Yeah, and one of the issues is, though, Call of the Wild, you need... clear for Call of the Wild, so you'd be really relying on the Pyro into equality to be able to clear that out. Because if Call of the Wild comes down and you have no way to do the AoE, well, what are you supposed to do? Like, all the heal in the world won't matter if you're getting hit for that kind of damage every single turn.
So how much damage this is? This is 1, 2, plus 7.
This is it.
This is 9. That's exactly enough with the wolf.
One of the worst cards in a control matchup. Actually helps finish the game with that one point of additional damage. And we see Tessin, the sort of double fist pump there, as that matchup was not as straightforward as the previous time he played Stan Sivka and just steamrolled it.
But I think it's because Stan Sivka was greedy there. He thought, like, okay, you don't have it. So he didn't deny the beast. He just left himself on 9. He felt like he's okay there. So there is no way that he's going to die, even though he had Forbidden Healing in hand and Lay on Hands as the follow-up. So
the problem as well is if he'd done the clear and left the barns up, he would have died anyway, right? Because the extra 2 damage from the kill command would have been the barns, 2 additional damage instead of the wolf being at 1.
Well, you do heal with the wolf, the Truce of a Champion, and go 1 up, and then you heal for 4 at least, so I think he should be fine.
Oh, yeah, would he have been 1 off, maybe?
Yeah, okay. Possibly. I think he was surviving with if he uses Forbidden Healing that turn. But I just want to quote Stan Sivka before this match. I asked Stan Sivka, how do you feel about it? And he says, oh yeah, he's running Unleash the Hound, so I think I have a chance.
Oh, famous fired. Last words. It's like, what a way to lose that matchup then. And we do see the Nuzoth.
Because honestly, versus Paladin, Unleash the Hound shouldn't be good, because there are minions, you are probably dying.
Hey, the reverse kill on the Enfin turn.
Yeah. Oh, man.
It could happen. But we are into the next matchup, and this could be the last game of this tournament, as Tessin is 2-1 up and he has got the winner's bracket advantage in this final. So if he wins this series, it's over.
We're done.
Stan Sivka wins, he gets to go again at Tessin.
So not really happy about the Haffer just dying to the 2-1, but overall about this matchup, I think this matchup is in most cases about Alexstrasza. If you get Alexstrasza's freeze mage, you just kill the hunter in time. If you don't get Alexstrasza, hunter will have the high mains. Hunter will have enough, the Call of the Wilds, he will have enough time so that you run out of freezes, and then if you don't have the damage, you just lose the game because they have those big minions you couldn't dealt with.
Yeah, this is tough. And again, we see Explosive Trap and Unleash the Hounds in hand. So kind of interesting choices in this deck, because the Nazoth sort of lends itself to the late game variant. You know, the Hunter trying to just really smash in those control matchups. But then you have Explosive Trap and Unleash, which obviously, you know, nods towards aggro matchups as well. So maybe an all-rounder list from Tessen, but seems to be performing pretty well so far.
Yeah, well, he does have three dead cards in his hand, but he had an okay opening, and he has Savannah Hymen as well. So far, he is pressuring Stun. And if he keeps getting good cards off the top, which should happen because he has those like kind of dead cards right now, he might position himself to be okay, but Stan also has a good hand.
Yep, this is awkward though. Stan has multiple freezes, so there's the first Frost Nova, he has the second in hand, and the Blizzard. So he can actually take his time here, and that kill command is huge.
It's really good, just killing the Doomsayer, being able to keep your board, and just invite Stan to keep doing the AoEs.
Yeah, that is actually massive, because if the Doomsayer came down there, it's such a massive loss of damage for Tessen, but he is able to keep hold of the board, and he's got the follow-up as well now of Hymen.
Well, Stan can go Frost Nova Doomsayer again, and this means not only he deals with this board, but he also blocks the possible Hymen next turn. Turn 7, it's not much that the Hunter can do.
It's okay if the Doomsayer comes down, it means Tessen's got an opening to play that Explosive Trap.
Yes.
You did not laugh as much as I expected. That
I didn't.
Come on.
I didn't. No.
Cut me some slack.
Dude,
okay.
Explosive Trap in this matchup, it's tough.
Exactly. It is pretty horrible. But looks like Ember's going to be the choice here. So Stan Sifka's you know, deciding that he needs the big reduction here to be able to make more impactful turns later on. And he can sit and just take 9 this turn. And also, the Hunter kind of needs to kill Emperor. You can't let Freeze Mage get multiple reductions or the game's swiftly going to go out of control. But he does have a nice way with kind of using the 5-2, sorry, to clear it off. And I kind of like the Emperor play there because you've just seen Kill Command and Quick Shot.
Yeah, also,
so,
like,
you know, that's a lot of just on-demand removal, so it forces the trade. But Tessen has been able to refill with the Hymen, which is replaces the Wolf in difficulty to remove.
Well, even if you see that, you still can go for Doomsayer Nova this turn. So then you kill the Hymen in theory. But let's see how much damage he has. Not that much yet. With Thalnos, Fireball is 7. Then you have 5 plus 4. It's 16 damage. So yeah, Alex Straza would be key. But now he needs to deal with his board. So
I think you have to Doomsayer here, right?
Yeah, Doomsayer Nova because his board is just
that 8 mana card that Hunter tends to have a couple of times, which would absolutely wreak havoc. So I think you forced in at least the freeze, but I imagine there's no reason not to go for the Doomsayer.
He is going for Acolyte. Okay. This means that he can go for Blizzard Doomsayer next turn. So you mentioned
the card
for 8 mana. Do you want to play this card for 8 mana right now? You might. But dude, Nazoth, those Deathrattle cards are going to come back. Mm-hmm. And they are hard to deal with. No, he can deal with them. That was the second freeze, by the way. So I'm not sure if he's playing double Blizzard, but he's running out of freezes.
Yeah. So I'm just thinking about this Call of the Wild. I think because you've got Nazoth, you could play the Grandmother this turn, Hero Power, and sure, play Explosive Trap. Because this banks another Death Rattle for turn 10, and then turn 9 you can play Call, because you get to see what the response was supposed to be from Call a lot of the time. So I think I'd like the Grandmother here, but
I don't hate the Call of the Wild because you've seen double Frost Nova already. So
yeah,
you know,
it still puts a lot of pressure, and the 2 damage from Blizzard, which is going to be the normal answer, still doesn't deal with most of the board here.
Yeah.
So, you know, this still piles on a lot of pressure. I wouldn't mind the Grandmother, but you can do it the other way around, play the Grandmother next turn, and maybe, you know, something else is going to draw, because in all seriousness, whipping an Explosive Trap does nothing.
This game is on an edge. If Stan Sivka keeps, if he gets Ice Block this turn from the Acolyte draw, and then Alex Straza next turn, the game is basically over. Or is it?
Yeah, I mean, he has the burn to finish the game from 15. And Hunter has no way to stop that kind of damage. There's no heal in the deck, of course.
Yeah, but Hunter has pressure right now, so
So he would need to draw into the Ice Block and Alex Straza, I think, in the next, literally the next 2 draws.
Unless he goes for the 30 damage combo, if that's possible.
No, not at this point. He's already used Thalnos now.
Well, Thalnos is on board, and if it doesn't die, you have a lot of damage spells in hand.
Good old Unleash the Hounds is for him.
It's pretty good, and you can use it.
2-1 health minions.
It's so good.
Go face.
Why is it so good versus Freeze Mage, though?
I think you actually definitely kill the Thalnos here.
Yeah.
You could just go face, though, with the other dog, because do you care about the Acolyte?
So if you have two dogs here, which one is the underdog?
Oh, maybe you do care about the Acolyte because it could hit the high main and then ping.
Okay. You absolutely ignored my joke.
Look, we're casting serious, Nimsh. Come on. I also missed the joke because I was talking over.
Okay,
so I apologize, Nimsh.
So I asked which one of those dogs is the underdog. But apparently
I'm glad I missed the joke.
Apparently and now the one who died.
Now regret asking you to explain it. Okay, so there is going to be the option of the ping into Blizzard, but it's not really going to help too much.
No, there's no Alexstrasza, there's no OTK.
We can see the Nuzlocke. Oh my god.
Yeah, Nuzlocke is going to be super good.
The high main will appear at some point next turn.
It's going to come back with...
It's either going to be there because it's not been killed, or it's going to come back from
Nuzlocke. Yeah. And there's like Infested Wolf as well, mm-hmm. and Kindly Grandmother comes back, mm-hmm. Fiery Bat comes back.
That's it. There's not been any Toads, right?
No Toads. Maybe, yeah, you might be right.
Yeah, I don't think we've seen Toads.
It's still good enough.
Oh, is it? You know what? Just the high main's good enough. That's
can you risk it right now? There is 10 damage.
You only need 5, I don't think so. 5, well, how much was there? 6? Oh, no, you don't need 3. Yeah, I don't think you could risk that at all. And there's the Doomsayer, which is going to lock out the Nuzlocke.
That's
to a certain
like
extent.
Well played. Oh. Well, you just slammed it.
So you just play high main.
Yeah, you play high main. But the thing is, aren't you dead? So, no, you're not dead.
No,
yet,
there's no Ice Block.
So Alexstrasza, if Alexstrasza is being played next turn,
you can... Ooh, so what, you need Call the Wild? I think, so if Alexstrasza's played this turn...
Yeah.
It means...
You're at 12, and there is an Ice Block.
Ooh.
Oh, man.
But you can't do them both?
Actually, you can play Ice Block this turn, and if Ice Block is not popped, you just... I like Ice... And you just play Alexstrasza next turn, and then you win after that, because you have, what, like, enough... should have enough.
Mm-hmm.
Almost.
Yeah, he's got enough.
Enough with the... Oh, now we can torch one of the high mains and then play the block, and I think that will be it, because you will have enough damage to finish this game. And that was basically it. Like, Alexstrasza and Ice Block, if you get those cards, this game can just flip on its head. Yeah. And even though there is Nuzlocke, it's just going to bring hell back. Everything's going back. Doesn't matter.
Yeah,
Nuzlocke, Alexstrasza,
MVP Doomsayer.
Oh, wait. He didn't play Ice Block this turn.
I mean, it's fine. He can't die anyway. He can't die this turn, regardless.
Yes.
Oh, hang on.
But then he can't play Alexstrasza anymore. So now if he plays Ice Block, that doesn't matter. Why didn't he play Ice Block?
No, because he used the torches, right?
But yeah, but like he could just use one torch and take a risk that Ice Block is not going... Isn't he dead now? Can he still win this?
Well, he's not dead this turn because of Ice Block.
Yeah, but overall, like, can you checkmate with Alexstrasza?
It's like kind of interesting. I mean, I'm a self-confessed not the best Freeze Mage player in the world.
I'm super surprised that he didn't go for the risk of the... Well, I guess like last time he just died because he disrespected Hunter's damage, so this time he was afraid, and that's why he went for...
Yeah, but you've seen Kill Command, and even a Call of the Wild doesn't do anything, right?
Yeah.
Because he was on enough health to just not die to Call Hero
He
power.
Was at, what, like 12. So Hymen is... well, the Hyena is 2 damage, so we get to 10, and then the Hero Power is 2, so we get to 8. Oh man, I think that's it. Like, he will not have enough damage to OTK, and the block is being popped right now. So because he didn't play that Ice Block, Tessin is going to win that game versus Freeze Mage.
Yeah.
Which means Tessin is going to win the whole tournament.
Yep. So already I want Laughing to tweet at me, if he's watching this, to let me know if that was the incorrect or correct play from Stansifka. Because I feel like no matter what anyone says about Freeze Mage, Laughing always has the last...
From our perspective, knowing both hands, knowing the fact that there is Nuzlocke, it was incorrect. But maybe in some spectrum, that was still a correct play to make, because maybe you put your opponent on something else. Mm-hmm. But Stan Sivka loses this game, and Tessin is the winner. Tessin is the victor. Oh man, undefeated! He didn't even lose in the grand final. He won versus Stan Sivka twice. He won versus JG twice. He won versus many other people. That was so crazy, so amazing. And Lothar is joining us here.
Yep, I'm here. And that's quite amazing. That undefeated, not losing a single match in the entire tournament. Well, what can we tell about that, right? Tessin also was representing himself and in the previous PGL and Tavern Tales, where he was actually showing some promises, right?
Mm-hmm.
And now, well... lives up to his name, and he won PGL Tavern Tales 2016.
Also, DreamHack Top 8, was it, right?
Yep.
DreamHack Top 8, he got from the 16th place. DreamHack was also a cool story because he lost, I think, the first two games.
Yeah, and then went all the way back.
Then, yeah, they won all the other games. Went to the top 16, and in the top 16, he ended up in the top 8 as well. So, yeah.
Super solid performance from Tessin. I'm really impressed, to be honest, in this lineup as well. From the instant we looked at the groups, we knew how stacked this tournament is. Literally a grouping of the best players in the world, and Tessin managed to edge it out all the way into first place without losing a series. And let's have a quick review. Yeah,
before we talk
Dan
with Tessin, let's have a look how the games went, so we can go through that again, guys.
Yeah, I like that play for sure. Just having more pressure there from Stansivka, and that was also pretty good for the Murloc.
How do you mean?
So in terms of the Murloc Paladin game versus the Warrior, Sivka just had all the correct answers at the right time. He was under a lot of pressure, but the second the Dragon Warrior from Tessin just runs out of juice and doesn't have a card like anything to be able to get the Warlock hero power to pile on the pressure, it just wasn't enough.
But the game again with the Paladin against the Hunter, which we'll see in a second, right? I was really surprised that Stansivka didn't use his Forbidding Healing in the last turn, right? It was crucial to take the control. We probably will see it in a few
especially
seconds.
Especially because there was follow-up from Leon Hands as
exactly,
well. Because you sort of create a turn that opens up Leon Hands being easier to play. Because that's difficult with that 8-mana card, right?
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, so this is almost the moment where Stan stabilizes, then is a bit greedier. That cost him the game. And then with the Freeze Mage game, it was the reverse.
Very similar, right?
Yeah, but it was reverse because he went for the more. Maybe he was like too greedy.
MVP Hound. Unleash the Hound.
And look at that. And they hand Leon Hands and Forbidden Healing just waiting to be used. And I think it was really greedy to wait just that one more turn, right? The Forbidden Healing could have been used for 4 mana. Heal for 8.
But honestly, if you don't die there, you probably just win because you heal for 20.
Yeah, but when you die, then you...
Okay, we need to look at this Freeze Mage. Lothar, you can be the third pair of eyes here. Hopefully we see it in the clip of the choice between just doing the... Sivka went for double torch on the Hyenas. He could have used one torch.
And Ice Block
and then
to set up Alexstrasza. We don't see it, basically,
the
Nizof was the big thing for Tessin. Nizof was something that Sivka did not expect. Tessin just built
up
a big...
We have Tessin here. So let's stop talking about the games. Congratulations, Tessin. You have already the trophy. What can you say? Just crushed everyone. So give us some feedback. How do you final went from your side?
Yeah, like I think this was really good overall. Like now I already played once against Transfiska, but yeah, I'm happy. Like the tournament is over. And
it's your first trophy as well, right?
Yeah, it's first time I got first place. So yeah, I'm really happy about it.
For sure, this is like the breakout performance for you. So I'm sure now everyone will know your name in our Hearthstone community. So kudos to that, and be sure to stream now. Because most of the players are missing that.
I will stream every day, so on. That's for sure.
There is a very cool thing happening here in DreamHack Bucharest overall, because the first winner of DreamHack was Gaara. Then the second one, Thijs, took the title from Gaara in the final. Then we had, I believe, Stansivka winning another one.
Yes.
And if we keep things in Bucharest, because we had Cluj-Napoca, but the last winner of DreamHack Bucharest was Stansivka. So you take the win from Stansivka in the final, and you are another champion.
Oh yeah, I'm so happy. Like I don't know what to say. I'm just happy. I prepared so much for this, and everything like it worked out. Like the Ben situation, I thought I won that, and I feel really good about my lineup against his. And
you know what they say, right? Right preparation, card gameplay, some luck, and you win a tournament.
Something like that.
Yeah, and you had all those things fall into the place today and in the past 2 days. So congratulations again. You didn't drop a single match, which is quite a feat. And not many people can say that they won a huge major tournament without dropping a single match. So that's quite an achievement. But I guess that's everything from us here at DreamHack Bucharest at PGL Tavern Tales. So from me, from Nimsh, from Raven, from Tessin as well, of course. Thank you very much for watching, guys. And I hope we'll tune in for the next PGL adventure, because there will be many, many more to come.